I'm Talia Ruscioni. I'm the Education Director at the Bateman Horne Center. Today, we're going to be hearing from Dr. Braden Yellman. He's going to be discussing anxiety and PTSD as it relates to long COVID and post-viral syndromes.
Good afternoon, everybody. We'll start here with question one. Is the rate of anxiety disorders, is it higher in those with post-acute sequelae of COVID than in the general population? Yes, no, the rate of anxiety disorders is actually less, or the data is inconclusive. So the actual answer is that the data is inconclusive. And I think that that is very much not the experience of clinicians working in the field, which goes to show what I think is a lack of understanding of these conditions in this patient population. And we will touch on that. So question number two, true or false? PASC patients manifesting with anxiety and or PTSD generally have previous psychiatric symptom histories. The correct answer in this one is false. It is rare to actually find people with previous psychiatric history and then PASC with previous symptoms as compared to brand new symptoms with the post-acute sequelae of COVID infection. Not impossible, but certainly more the exception than the rule. And question number three, which of the following pathologies can be directly triggered or exacerbated by excess or exaggerated sympathetic nervous system signaling in those diagnosed with anxiety or with PTSD? Is it endothelial dysfunction, immune system dysregulation, microcirculation perturbations or coagulopathies, excess pro-inflammatory cytokine expression and release, or all of the above? Good job, guys. It is all of the above. Excess sympathetic nervous system signaling that we detect in people with anxiety or PTSD do show signs of all of these dysfunctions, especially in our PASC population. So with that, I will get started with the presentation here. All right. So today we are, as you've caught, talking about anxiety and PTSD in our PASC patients. To the earlier question I asked, what are the rates of anxiety after an acute COVID-19 infection? So this has been looked at actually through systematic reviews involving at least 15 studies assessing anxiety after mild to moderate COVID-19 infection. Within these studies, they included over 3,400 patients who 17.5% of those 3,400 patients actually had at least mildly severe, whatever that means, anxiety symptoms. The anxiety prevalence in patients who had a severe initial COVID-19 reaction was 19% of a total of 309 patients, but that doesn't necessarily correlate with the severity of their anxiety. That could be a mild to moderate anxiety. They did use sensitivity analysis in this systematic review, and it showed a decrease in anxiety prevalence from about 20% to 11% as time passed from the initial trigger or initial infection, so 1 to 3 month follow-up versus more than 3 months, that rate of anxiety decreased. There was also, importantly, inconsistency in how anxiety prevalence was detected in different studies based upon the different tools that were used to assess those symptoms, right? We've used the GAD-7 or generalized anxiety disorder 7 screening. There is the state trait anxiety scale and even the hospital anxiety and depression score. So depending on the tool, the rates varied quite a bit. What was interesting to me that stood out is that self-reported anxiety prevalence among these patients is significantly higher than those who receive a clinical diagnosis from a clinician for anxiety. But the overall message here is that the prevalences of anxiety are thought to be consistent with the general population. What about in PTSD? There were 13 studies in this meta-analysis that measured PTSD in non-severe COVID-19 cases. 7 of these studies measured the PCL5 or post-traumatic stress disorder checklist questionnaires. 1 used the trauma screening questionnaire, 2 used the Davidson trauma scale, and 3 used the impact of event scale revised. And they found an overall prevalence of PTSD that was about 17.5% out of 3,400 patients. Again, looking at cases of severe COVID-19 infection, we saw a 19% prevalence of any kind of PTSD in those patients. So only a slight bump based on the severity of their infection. And then PTSD prevalence in cohorts of patients were followed for 1 to 3 months, and again, 3 months or longer. And you do see a decline in the rates of PTSD as you get farther out from that initial infection. So these prevalences are also thought to be similar to those in the general population. And so there's a lot of discussion out in the medical world right now that, hey, anxiety and PTSD are not increased as a result of COVID-19 infection. But I don't think that tells us the whole story, because when we are assessing those studies there, we're really looking at all people infected with COVID-19. We're not looking specifically at a subpopulation of people who actually develop long COVID or PASC symptoms, right? So global meta-analyses of over 29 studies find a rate of 43% of people developing PASC to some degree. It depends on the way that they define that. And up to 57% among those who are hospitalized with the acute phase of the infection. So we're dealing with somewhere between 40 and 60% of people who had those COVID diagnoses. So that other 40% from the data we just looked at may not be relevant to this question. Interestingly, we do see slightly higher rates of long COVID in Asia compared with Europe, and then slightly higher in Europe compared with North America. And we do see the rates of post-acute sequelae of COVID beginning to increase after 90 days or that three-month time period, and even further at 120 days as compared with 30 and 60 days, which I think is really, again, just about how we define PASC. But again, we're looking at specifically the PASC patients, not just all comers who have had infection with COVID-19, which at this point is a lot of our global society. So here we have a systematic review of symptoms in those diagnosed with long COVID. And as you can see here, there are two columns. One is for people in the first 4 to 12 weeks, as PASC is sometimes defined, and then the other is 3 months or 12 weeks and greater. And so for post-traumatic stress disorder, there is a rate of 23% of those with PASC reporting or being diagnosed with PTSD in that first 4 to 12 weeks, and that goes down to 18% after 12 weeks. Anxiety, interestingly enough, is 19% in those first 4 to 12 weeks, and actually increases as time goes by in our patients who meet the definition of PASC, and that's increased up to 32%. However, as you can see here with the grading of the data, there are no little green squares in any of this. A lot of this data is not the most high quality data. So we really do have some inconclusive evidence about what is actually going on. And a lot of it is self-reported or varies significantly based on the tools used to measure. That is a little different than what we actually see in the clinic, right? And when we assess the most common symptoms reported by our patients with PASC, you'll see that the 15 most common symptoms, anxiety and depression, is on that list and occurs in about a 65% rate, and interestingly, even higher rate in males compared to females. And then the 15 most common symptoms with the highest severity also include anxiety and depression among our PASC patients, and that is 23% of those patients with PASC feeling that this is a severe manifestation of their illness. This is taking a look at the PASC population a little more closely, really just saying, look, the people who develop long COVID, many of them, as we've stated in some of our earlier lectures, do have things like POTS or orthostatic intolerance, or they may have joint hypermobility syndrome, or what we generally referred to as hypermobile EDS at this point. And so we can see in the top left corner there that when you assess controls versus patients with POTS, and this is not PASC patients, this is just all comers with POTS, that there are significantly higher reports of symptoms, both cognitive, cardiac, gastrointestinal, respiratory, dissociation, humiliation, all of these symptoms in a patient diagnosed with anxiety occur at higher percentages than they do in the control population. And then we have many case control studies that have been reviewed and found to confirm an association between joint hypermobility syndrome and anxiety disorders in both directions. So you can see here that joint hypermobility syndrome actually increases the absolute risk for panic disorder by 44.1% versus 2.8% in non-hypermobile subjects. And that's a relative risk of 22.3%. Pretty impressive there. We also see in the right side of this slide here that panic and agoraphobia, the relative risk increases by 22.3%, relative, not absolute risk, in patients with joint hypermobility syndrome, more so than we see with social phobia, simple phobia, or generalized anxiety disorder. So it really tends to present in our hypermobile patients more as a panic disorder than some of the other ways we look at generalized anxiety disorders. So again, I'm just making the argument here that among our PASC population who have these other conditions either developed during PASC or had them prior to PASC, there is an increased risk for anxiety disorders. So really that brings us to the next question, which is, could the anxiety and or PTSD we are recognizing or diagnosing or suspecting in our PASC population actually be driven by some of the underlying dysautonomia? And no matter how much you comb the literature, there is really an absolute paucity of data on this question. So, and I think part of that is based on how we even define dysautonomia. It can be very limited to just cardiac manifestations. There's a lot of debate in the dysautonomia literature about how to define it, which is probably why the data is so lacking. However, when we put our clinical hats on and we see patients in the clinic, I hear this list that we have right in front of us of symptoms all the time. And in particular, I hear things about internal tremor sensations, that patients wake up in the middle of the night with their heart rate at 180 to 220 beats per minute. They were not having a nightmare in these cases sometimes. They literally just woke up in a state of panic with no clear cognitive trigger for it. They experience those in the day too. They can be sitting watching TV. There can be no associated event that triggers a memory of something stressful, and yet their heart rate increases, they start sweating, they show symptoms of sympathetic overdrive, anxiety, or what might be considered a panic attack, or what they often describe to us as a panic attack. Excessive sweating, blurry vision, which remember, there are vision changes associated with large rushes of sympathetic outflow. Nightmares, but these importantly are not nightmares that surround their patients' experiences regarding their COVID infection, regarding fear of the pandemic itself, or regarding the symptoms they're experiencing as part of their PASC. They're totally different nightmares, sometimes goofy about dinosaurs or acid rain or whatever the case is. Chest tightness, palpitations, and insomnia. The number of PASC patients that come in experiencing these symptoms is way higher in my experience. And I think a lot of the clinicians who focus on these patients than what is reported in the data I just shared with us. And it's important to remember that the majority of these patients had no prior psych history before their COVID-19 infection. So how do we assess this? And I think we really are looking at least some contribution of their dysautonomia contributing to these symptoms or this expression of pathophysiology here. It is an exercise that I thought is worth going through. If you think about somebody with dysautonomia and then go back and look at our clinically defined criteria for anxiety according to the DSM-5, it's amazing how closely the symptoms can resemble one another, right? So it's sort of an exercise to think about, you know, could this actually be describing somebody with a dysautonomia and not actually a primary anxiety disorder, but maybe a secondary manifestation of anxiety? So what are the criteria? Excessive anxiety and worry for more days than not for at least 6 months about a number of events and activities. We could argue the number of events and activities may not be as applicable to our dysautonomia or PASC population, but they certainly often will have symptoms for 6 months or more. The individual finds it difficult to control the worry. If we replace worry with symptoms, it is often very difficult to control in our PASC population or our dysautonomia population. Certainly, many of our patients have expressed fatigue, difficulty concentrating, restlessness, irritability, difficulty concentrating. We had a great lecture on that last week. muscle tension and significant sleep disturbances, which include difficulty falling asleep, difficulty staying asleep, feeling restless in sleep, having sleep feel unsatisfying or unrestorative, significant distress or impairment in functioning, including social and occupational functioning. We definitely see that in our PASC patients, in our ME/CFS patients, and in our other patients with dysautonomia. And then saying this disturbance is not attributable to the physiological effects of a drug or medication. And often these patients are coming to us before they've been tried on medication. So outside of the definition in A there, which says about a number of events and activities, I think it's easy to see how this could be interpreted, these symptoms could be interpreted in multiple ways in the same patient. The same is actually true, I think, when you look at the criteria for PTSD, which are the following. So a traumatic event exposure, directly experiencing, witnessing, or learning about an event either in yourself or in a close acquaintance, and experiencing repeated or extreme exposure to that traumatic event details triggers symptoms. This one, again, kind of like part A in our anxiety population, is maybe a little bit debatable. I think people would say the PTSD event might have been the pandemic itself, or perhaps the severe COVID infection and the hospitalization related to it. And I think that is an assumption that we make as clinicians that we don't always delve into as deeply as we should when we're making this diagnosis on our PASC population. Letter B, the presence of one or more intrusion symptoms associated with this traumatic event. So recurrent distressing memories, dreams, dissociative events or flashbacks where people relive events, psychological distress in response to event-related cues, or physiological reactions to event-related cues. We see the psychological distress and physiological reactions to symptoms very commonly in our PASC patients and in our dysautonomia patients. We see these patients avoid stimuli, in particular stimuli that actually trigger their symptoms of dysautonomia, which might be misinterpreted as avoiding stimuli that remind them of a traumatic event. We definitely see alterations in cognition and mood, including exaggerated negative beliefs about oneself. People start to lose their sense of self-worth. I can't work anymore. I can't do the things that I associate with my identity. So there's this positive, or I should say negative, positive feedback loop about these exaggerated beliefs with negative emotions, feelings of detachment, and inability to experience positive emotions. We do see, of course, marked alterations in arousal and hyperreactivity in dysautonomia, including irritable behavior, occasional angry outbursts, even in people who are very calm prior to infection or to developing dysautonomia symptoms, hypervigilance, exaggerated startle response. If you ask, you'll find so many people feel that somebody enters the room, they don't recognize it, then they jump out of their seat, not realizing they were there. Difficulty with concentration, again, sleep disturbances, again, symptoms present for more than 1 month. That is part of the definition of PASC. Again, distress, these symptoms causing distress or impairment in social, occupational, and other functioning, again, part of PASC as well. And of course, that these symptoms are not because of medications or other medical conditions. And in this case, we are making an argument that it might be another medical condition. It might be PASC, it might be dysautonomia, as part of that PASC presentation. So this is just another way to say that the picture really is, I think, pretty murky, and that we define these illnesses without biomarkers, with clinical criteria that are still somewhat imperfect. And there's a lot of crossover there. So we want to just be vigilant, to use that word again, that we are not missing some dysautonomia contributions or even causes to symptoms of anxiety and PTSD. So that then begs the question, as I make this argument here, how might COVID-19 infection actually cause dysautonomia? And again, the answer is we don't totally know, but there are some proposed mechanisms that I think make a lot of sense. And these are a lot of the ones that you'll find in the literature currently. So hypovolemia is thought to potentially trigger hyperadrenergic POTS or orthostatic intolerance, leading to cerebral hypoperfusion and impairment of the central autonomic networks, not just our cognitive function, but those autonomic networks that we see in our central nervous system. Not only that, but there can be brainstem dysfunction, and that may be the result of direct viral invasion. It may be neuroinflammation and glial cell activation. It may be vascular activation. It may be brainstem compression, such as in the case of hypermobility with craniocervical instability. But remember that the brainstem also houses many of the autonomic centers. And so irritation or pathology in that area could really be driving these symptoms, or perhaps making them more difficult to treat than in a more, quote, traditional anxiety or PTSD patient. Autoimmunity has been implicated. We see autoantibodies to G protein-coupled receptors that have been observed in our PASC patients. These autoantibodies can increase sympathetic tone by activating the adrenergic receptors and by having an allosteric effect on the muscarinic G protein-coupled receptors. Autoantibody activation of adrenergic and cholinergic receptors can lead to inappropriate peripheral vasodilation or just vascular changes that are inappropriate. We have seen antiphospholipid antibodies elevated in PASC patients, both in patients who develop antiphospholipid syndrome and in patients who develop mast cell activation syndrome following their COVID-19 infection. And then there's been all kinds of other elevated autoantibodies described, including anti-nuclear antibody, which is, of course, any autoantibody that attaches to the nucleus without clear definition of what that autoantibody is. We've seen different versions of anti-thyroid antibodies, anti-cardiac protein antibodies, and Sjogren's antibodies. Whether or not these are playing a role in pathology is yet to be determined, but these rates are higher in our PASC patients than our general population for sure, and even higher than, say, other post-infection states. I wouldn't say higher than post-infectious syndromes like the ones we see causing CFS, but certainly higher than after a cold virus or perhaps even something like monkeypox. Another proposed mechanism is postganglionic sympathetic neuron damage. So we're now talking about in the periphery. Again, is that possibly due to direct viral invasion? Is it related to the immune milieu in which these neurons are sitting, especially when there is an immune attack with collateral damage against peripheral virus? And then excessive mast cell activation. So the inappropriate release of histamine and all the other cytokines that we talked about in our mast cell lecture in response to physical activity or orthostatic stress can lead to orthostatic tachycardia, flushing, headaches, and GI symptoms, some of which really fit into our paradigm of anxiety or PTSD for these patients. So case reports show improvement in dysautonomia after we treat mast cell activation and PASC. And I would argue in the clinical setting, I also see improvements in symptoms of anxiety and symptoms that may be attributable to PTSD when we treat these syndromes. So, do methods for reducing sympathetic nervous system signaling and transmission, do those methods reduce symptoms of anxiety and PTSD in those with post-acute sequelae of COVID? That's really the million-dollar question for us clinicians, right? Can we actually identify this and treat this in a way that is maybe slightly different than our traditional or is the same as our traditional anxiety and PTSD cases? And I think the answer is undoubtedly yes for all of those who've been doing this for some time now. One thing that I think is worth bringing up, and I don't bring this up to start because I think it's the most important treatment, but I think it is sort of instructive of some of the physiology here, and that is the old procedure of a stellate ganglion injection. So remember, we have a cervical sympathetic chain, which includes superior, middle, and inferior cervical ganglions, as well as the first thoracic ganglion. And this chain provides sympathetic innervation to the head, neck, upper limbs, upper thoracic region, which includes the heart, the lungs, the lacrimal salivary glands, the thyroid glands, and the pineal gland. So a lot of innervation in this little tiny area. And they call that whole area the stellate ganglion. And you'll actually see a fusion of the inferior cervical and first thoracic ganglia present in 80% of individuals. So that's a part of this whole sympathetic chain network. This is an old procedure in which injection of local anesthetic, usually procaine, into this sympathetic chain, or known as a stellate ganglion block, is used to improve blood flow and deactivate or reset overall sympathetic tone in these patients. And actually, they say when it's done correctly, when it's done effectively, it will sometimes cause a iatrogenic Horner syndrome with ipsilateral ptosis, meiosis, and anhidrosis, as well as some facial flushing. That's, though nobody really wants those side effects, it's a sign of a very effective or aggressive sympathetic ganglion injection. So this is a procedure that was originally described in the 1930s and was used for treatment of reflex sympathetic dystrophy, which we now call complex regional pain syndrome. And of course, that is thought to be sympathetically mediated pathophysiology driving that pain syndrome. It has also been used effectively to treat Raynaud's and hyperhidrosis in the upper limbs, as well as in PTSD, and in hot flashes that are associated with patients who are undergoing chemotherapy or have pretty wild hormone shifts in menopause. It's important to point out the pro-inflammatory cytokine and chemokine profile recognized in those with PASC has been associated with and even implicated in excessive sympathetic nervous system activity. And so the thought process is, well, if there's a lot of excess sympathetic activity in these patients, no matter the cause, can we use a stellate ganglion injection to improve those symptoms? And in fact, that theory was tested in a very small case series out of Alaska, where stellate ganglion injections were provided to two patients to see if downregulation of their sympathetic overdrive could improve not only symptoms of anxiety and depression, but other symptoms of post-acute sequelae of COVID. So here we have that data. We've got pre and post-COVID, 1 day post-treatment with stellate ganglion injection, 7 days post-treatment, and then 2 months post-treatment. And I would focus in here on depression and anxiety. And you can see that after treatment, their rates of depression or anxiety decreased significantly in this patient. And this patient had pretty high anxiety that dropped down significantly as well. But you'll also see a downward trend in a lot of the symptoms in both of these patients. You could argue some of that is the natural course of their post-acute sequelae of COVID. Maybe these people were diagnosed too early. They're only 1 to 3 months into their illness and they were going to get better anyway. But this did provide a basis for people to really start thinking about stellate ganglion injections in these patients. So here is an overview of the affected systems that a viral infection like COVID-19 can cause that are related to autonomic nervous system dysfunction. And we touched on this earlier. It can affect the immune system, hyperinflammation or excess inflammation of pro-inflammatory cytokines. It can affect endothelial dysfunction and coagulopathy. So if the autonomic nervous system is infected after COVID-19, all of these systems can be perturbed. Here is just a drawing showing that the autonomic nervous system and the immune system are in constant flux and communication, both centrally and periphery. So again, trying to reduce autonomic signaling may help with hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis dysfunction or sympathoadrenal system. It may help with sensory fibers, with cytokines, et cetera. And of course, this includes these central areas that we talked about, as well as the peripheral areas that are involved in the autonomic nervous system. So how do stellate ganglion injections really help? They're thought to block and simultaneously regulate systems linked to this autonomic nervous system. So we see this sympathetically maintained interdependent positive feedback loop that involves the neurological system and the immune system that can eventually reorganize itself or auto-regulate after changes of state, such as a stellate ganglion block. That is a fancy way of saying after injecting anesthetic, we are almost resetting that stellate ganglion and breaking this positive feedback loop and kind of bringing it back down to a baseline level of function and activation. Previous clinical data suggest that repeated temporary stellate ganglion blocks with local anesthetic procaine is capable of regulating these sympathetically triggered neurogenic inflammatory processes. And really that would, you know, the question then becomes, why are we not doing a ton of these? Why is this not more prevalent in PTSD and some of our other sympathetic overdrive conditions? And it's really because of the lack of direct measurements that are in the autonomic nervous system. Lack of direct ways of measuring pain, of immune function, of inflammatory processes that play a role in this that are probably limiting our use. In other words, we're not gathering good data on these procedures because it's really hard to measure that data in the first place. So there may be a role for stellate ganglion injections in patients with anxiety and PTSD, both outside of the PASC population, but especially in the PASC population as well. And I've certainly tried this with a few of my patients and to mixed results. The more you look into it, the more efficacy you would expect with repeated injections. So maybe one injection is not enough to really break this positive feedback loop, or if there's enough other signals going on in a PASC patient, either mast cell activation, vascular dysregulation, et cetera, that may still be driving this sympathetic overdrive, and you may need to address some of those symptoms first before you can see symptomatic improvement with stellate ganglion injections. But what are some of our more kind of traditional treatments that we have used in other conditions and that really apply to our PASC patients? Well, beta blockers are pretty tried and true here. Remember, the reason we're using these is because the adrenergic receptors have alpha and beta receptors. So by blocking the beta receptors, you are reducing adrenergic signaling. We often will use propranolol as a first-line agent. There's both short-acting propranolol, the kind that is thought to be helpful for things like panic disorder, but also for stage fright. I remember giving my brother a little bit before he had to give a best man speech at a wedding, and it was pretty helpful. And then there's long-acting or extended-release propranolol, which I'll often dose at night to help people both fall asleep and stay asleep by blocking some of that excess hyperadrenergic activity, but then also to kind of regulate their adrenergic activity for the subsequent 24 hours. Atenolol is more of a 12 to 16 hour kind of medication. So if you only want to use it in the evening or only during the daytime, maybe not quite as effective as propranolol, but there's certainly a patient population that responds. And I know Dr. Bateman uses a lot of metoprolol. I use a little bit less of it, but it's also pretty effective. It's important to also point out here that, again, this is not because of the heart rate suppression itself that these drugs are helpful. And that's why we don't see ivabradine or Korlynor having any direct effect for patients with these symptoms, because it doesn't actually have a direct effect on the sympathetic nervous system, just on heart rate alone. We also use alpha blockers. Clonidine is an alpha 2A agonist that reduces peripheral sympathetic outflow that I use quite often. Guanfacine is sort of an older drug that is used in ADHD, but is also a selective alpha 2A agonist that will often work like clonidine if the patient can't tolerate clonidine because of vascular considerations. And then there's a select few people who really fit more in the PTSD, like pathophysiology, have a bit more nightmares and hypervigilance only at night, where alpha-1 blockers like prazosin can be particularly helpful. Is there a role for benzodiazepines? And remember, benzodiazepines bind to GABA-A receptors. This then potentiates GABA neurotransmission, increases influx of chloride into neurons, and that influx of chloride then increases the threshold for neuronal excitability. So it is harder to become excitable, essentially, with a benzodiazepine on board. The benzodiazepines that I have found helpful include diazepam, either scheduled or as needed, depending on how symptoms are presenting, clonazepam, if you just need to reduce baseline activation, and then if it really is infrequent that people have symptoms, but sort of unexpected, carrying a little lorazepam around can be helpful. Why do I look at benzodiazepines, though? I know this can sometimes be a little controversial, right? In traditional anxiety disorders, we say, hey, this is a disorder of central nervous system neurotransmitters. Therefore, if we want to treat this effectively, let's use something that targets those central nervous system neurotransmitters rather than something that's a little more dirty, if you will, and has effects on the peripheral nervous system. That's the point, that it actually, there are many peripheral nervous system as well as glial cell benzodiazepine receptors, and that, quote, dirtiness of the drug actually is beneficial in our PASC and dysautonomia populations. So these peripheral benzodiazepine receptors are present in particularly high concentrations on immune cells, platelets, erythrocytes, and cells within the GI tract as well. And some of these peripheral benzodiazepine receptors have also been implicated in regulation of mitochondrial function. So this kind of ties back into many of the pathophysiologies we will see in our ME/CFS and PASC populations and those with dysautonomia. I think the fact that we are reducing peripheral excitability as well as central nervous system excitability is actually a distinct advantage of using benzodiazepines in this population, although I'm sure there are people who might disagree with me here. Vagal maneuvers. What are vagal maneuvers? These are maneuvers that are designed to essentially trigger the vagus nerve to increase overall parasympathetic tone. So our cranial nerves are responsible for our cardiac vagal stimulation, and they participate in the trigeminal brainstem vagal pathways. These are located in the face area, the head and neck regions. So we can actually use cold exposure to activate these nerves. And this is actually referred to as the diving reflex. And that involves a pattern of respiratory, cardiac, and vascular responses that are thought to, you know, originally through evolution, help control oxygen conservation and survival when diving. So it's this reflex that we try to take advantage of to actually control sympathetic overdrive in patients with anxiety and PTSD in our PASC populations. Here on the left, we have a measurement here of the different areas, the neck, the cheek, and the forearm with cold exposure. We have controls here, and we have our cold exposure here. And this is really the normalized root mean square of successive differences of body locations for cold stimulus. That's a fancy statistical measure for saying heart rate variability. Heart rate variability improves with cold exposure. So it actually gets better, which is a sign of more parasympathetic activity. They've also measured mean interbeat intervals of all body locations for cold stimulus, which is a statistical measure of just a heart rate response in general. And you will see that the biggest response again is in the neck and improves with cold exposure as compared to in controls. In our population, there are kind of two main ways I'll ask my patients to attempt vagal maneuvers. The first is to fill a basin with cold water or maybe ice water and to actually dunk their face and neck into it several times for up to 2 minutes, you know, obviously taking enough breaths to not get short of breath. Or alternatively, when they take a shower, to finish that shower with 1 to 2 minutes of ice cold water. I once had a patient in Tucson who said, yeah, we don't get that here. So I recommended the basin approach. But people will provide this cold exposure over their face and neck and then can feel a significant improvement in their overall anxiety symptoms for minutes to hours to up to the whole rest of the day. So I have people do this to start their day. I have people do this in the evenings as part of their sleep hygiene routine to help them not have hypervigilance going into sleep. I also have them try it in situations where they feel like they might be approaching sort of a panic-like situation with some great success. There are also some people who really like to implement treatments where there is conscious control over autonomic responses. I think the traditional way of looking at this is something like biofeedback therapy with very specific relaxation techniques. In other words, we let a patient attempt specific relaxation techniques or ways to try to focus on controlling their autonomic nervous system consciously, and then they get readbacks of how well they're doing by measuring all kinds of vital signs, for example. And this has been used in several areas of medicine, but has been helpful in my patients who have attempted this for their PASC symptoms. Over here on the right, we have meditation as another example for ways to try to calm the autonomic nervous system with conscious overdrive. And then we have a collection of programs that are marketed out there for neural retraining, right? For limbic retraining, things like the dynamic neural retraining system and the Gupta program. I've had plenty of patients undergo these programs and see significant results. I do not think the reason is actually because we are necessarily reprogramming the limbic system. Most neuroscience data would suggest that takes at least 3 months. And I see my patients benefit from these programs much earlier than that. So what I suspect is happening here is that these programs promote exercises for limbic retraining that are actually helping those patients exert conscious control over their autonomic nervous system as well to reduce their symptomatic response or their exaggerated symptomatic responses. It's always important to treat comorbidities, right? We talked about uncontrolled orthostatic intolerance can drive exacerbation of sympathetic overdrive. Mast cell activation significantly worsens sympathetic overdrive and anxiety. Neurological sensitivities to light and sound, to conversations, to other multiple sensory inputs can certainly exacerbate these symptoms. For those, we sometimes consider aripiprazole or dextromethorphan, but that's for another talk. And then remember that sympathetic overdrive is usually worse when a patient is in post-exertional malaise. So it's always important to remind them to avoid PEM, or if they're in PEM, to wait it out. Remember, there's not much you can do to get out of PEM other than wait for it to get over. There's not much you can do in that moment. So if they're not responding to some of those other treatments, it might be break the PEM cycle. This is sort of just starting to come into our consciousness, but could transcranial magnetic stimulation be used in the future to target the dorsal left prefrontal cortex, the pregenual, I think I pronounced that correctly, and mid anterior cingulate cortexes? It has been used at this frequency in Hertz to contribute to parasympathetic tone via the vagus nerve and shown improvements in things like diaphragmatic function and excess breathing, essentially, or hyperventilation. It has not been looked at specifically for anxiety and PTSD, but that is sort of a future consideration that people are looking into. I do want to comment on sleep very briefly. Sympathetic overdrive, in my experience, is the most common cause of sleep disturbances in those with PASC or ME/CFS. With pain being the second most common cause. So when patients can't fall asleep, when they have nightmares, they wake up frequently or too early, their mind is racing, or their circadian rhythm is disrupted where they are awake at night and asleep in the day, consider addressing sympathetic overdrive. And then also remember that stimulant therapies are often prescribed to improve our brain fog, attention, and other cognitive complaints in PASC, but these stimulants can alter or worsen sympathetic overdrive and hypervigilance. And I find it to be best practice to implement these therapies only after making some clinical improvements in the symptoms of sympathetic overdrive first. So sorry that went a little over, but we can open it up to questions and to Dr. Bateman's case.
That was a lot of really good information, Dr. Yellman. And I know that, you know, it's not easy to try to get through something as complex as that, but I think that you deliver that really well. So let's open up the floor. What questions do you guys have for Dr. Yellman, Bateman, or Dr. Brown?
Or alternatively, comments from Dr. Bateman and Dr. Brown, because a lot of this is clinician experiential given our lack of published data.
So TMS, we actually have that here at the U in what used to be called Uni, which is now the Huntsman Mental Health Center. I looked into it because I was getting questions from referrals, like, well, should we be looking at this for patients who have anxiety and depression related, at least what we're picking up after COVID? And there isn't a lot of data right now for that specific population, but there is, you know, known protocols and actually efficacy that's actually comparable to some just drug regimens for anxiety and depression. The issue being that cost and time is an issue for that kind of treatment. So I think that's a TBD. The one concern I do have with the ganglion blocks is they kind of ended up in sort of the free-for-all for-pay clinic. And also there's like the placebo effect and also like, you know, intent. You would need to do a really good study that had an intention to treat analysis with a sham injection to really show that this works. Otherwise, I think it's just, unfortunately, I see patients paying a lot of money and I have no idea what they're paying for. And that's the part that bothers me a little bit. But I mean, I think it's an interesting concept. It's just, it needs to be well studied.
I couldn't agree more. I didn't mean to suggest that was a first line therapy so much as a consideration and something that people are out there doing.
No, for sure. Good job.
Dr. Bateman.
I kind of see a stellate gram block as a way to see if increasing parasympathetic tone is helpful, right? As opposed to a sustaining treatment. The same way we give IV fluids to people who have hypovolemia to help them understand, you know, how, or people with, you know, orthostatic intolerance. So what I try to do is help people understand that almost anything that improves parasympathetic tone and reduces sympathetic tone is helpful, right? From like your slide, Dr. Yellman, you know, anything from meditation to, you know, relaxation techniques, all the way up to procedures that can do it neurologically. But for long term, you know, it's really important to have something sustainable and affordable and safe, right? And there's absolutely nothing dangerous about doing non-procedural methods to do that. And then there's a little more risk as you go, but sometimes helping people understand the benefit can be useful.
There's a question in the chat that says use of vagal nerve stimulators. I've not seen anybody, I mean, I've seen people use them for other things, but I've not seen anybody use them for this currently. I don't know if you guys have.
Dr. Bateman, I think Dr. Vernon in our clinic used vagal nerve stimulators at one time in our ME/CFS population before I joined Bateman Horne Center. Do you have any memories or thoughts of that?
We had some vagal nerve stimulators for a little while, the ones that got approved for treating migraine, and as a chance to use them. I see them as just another tool to raise parasympathetic tone. They are effective. But again, it's something you have to do over and over and over in order to get sustained benefit. So if you have access to a vagal nerve stimulator and you want, you know, and you want to use it, it's also less dangerous, right, than stellate ganglion block, because much shorter term, probably not as effective and less long lasting, but based on similar principles. There's a question in the chat about using monitors from Dr. Lee Smith. Now that heart rate variability is clinically available, would that be valuable in measuring autonomic dysfunction and responses to specific treatments? I would say yes, especially overnight. And most of those devices measure heart rate variability overnight. And I talk to patients about how sympathetic overdrive can be destructive to their sleep, and let them monitor heart rate variability to assess their interventions for sleep and their success in doing that.
I do that often as well.
Mm-hmm. Good questions. Okay, Dr. Bateman, I want to allow a little bit of time for your case example.
Are there any more questions you can take, sorry, while I'm getting ready?
There is one. How would you approach prescribing benzos, considering that there is the potential for developing tolerance with long-term use?
Yeah, I probably use maybe a few more benzos than Dr. Bateman does. I am generally finding that if I find a decent dose that helps people, that they don't require significant dose escalation over time, that generally continues to work for them. What I have not seen, for what it's worth, any cases of a kind of psychological dependence, but of course there is a physiological dependence that develops. You know, I think that for me, I tend to see the PASC patients when they're a little more chronic, maybe a year or more into their illness, at which point we could also define them as ME/CFS, and I see a lot of chronic ME/CFS patients. In that population, we essentially are kind of saying we don't think they're ever going to see a cure so much as symptom management. And if it's a tool that's really helpful in managing their symptoms, I think one can make the argument that if they're not abusing it and they're not taking with opioids or in high doses, that it's not necessarily going to increase their morbidity and mortality, and it's going to make an enormous difference in their functional status. So when I feel that that's the case is when I feel okay using the benzos in this population.
So this is the case I just wanted to share with you that we'll see how much time we have for it. But this is a woman who's an identical twin. I know her because her sister has ME/CFS, and her sister's had ME/CFS since she was about 16. But this is the well twin. She's hypermobile. She's been on SSRIs since adolescence for what I think of as anxiety with features of OCD. Really, she's a perfectionist. She got married. She has two children. She has Hashimoto's and has been treated with hypothyroidism. But the story I want to tell you is that she got COVID. First of all, her husband got it, and she managed to avoid it in January 2021. She got her vaccine series. And maybe the fact that that second one gave her a little symptoms was a little bit of a clue that she might be reacting. But in August 2021, she got COVID. Of course, when everybody did, the kids brought it home. And she started with pretty mild symptoms. But then she had kind of a second wave of symptoms, which is kind of what we see in long COVID: brain fog, exhaustion, chest tightness. She kind of had weird pain and chest tightness. And she was just careful and was getting better. Then she got her booster. And she just sort of drizzled along, didn't write come 100% back. But in November, she just kind of had a busy day outside the house, nothing horrible, but her symptoms exploded. She developed widespread pain, stiffness, exhaustion, and she started just panicking and getting hugely anxious. She couldn't sleep. She was ruminating. She was having panic attacks and immobilized, really. And I have to say, she was terrified she was getting ME/CFS, right? Because her sister had had it. So I sent her, but long story short, after doing quite a bit, we sent her for a tilt table test. And it was given, the results were given verbally to me, but so I don't have all the data, but she had pretty normal vital signs at baseline, supine. And immediately her blood pressure dropped, her heart rate jumped up. At some point, I'm not sure the exact minutes, her heart rate was 116. She was looking like she was getting presyncopal, and she had a full syncopal event at 7 minutes. So she met criteria for POTS, except what we often see is it's not really the classic POTS where the blood pressure stays stable. right? Because she came really close to meeting systolic orthostatic hypotension in the first 3 minutes, which is a drop of 20. So my question is, what do we think about her course? And maybe in the interest of time, I won't stop and have Dr. I was going to have Dr. Yellman talk about her, but let me just tell you the rest of her story and then we'll see if there are any questions. So it's interesting because we actually, this is important to know, we actually did orthostatic testing, a nasaline test. So the in-home 10-minute passive lean test. And it really looked normal, but she was so worried that she was getting orthostatic intolerance that she was drinking 2 to 3 liters a day. And I think it blunted the findings on her test. So when we sent her for the tilt table test, really, she had those remarkable results. So this is an example of sometimes you need to pursue it when people have dramatic symptoms. But she also had dramatic anxiety, I have to say. So this is what we did to treat her main symptoms for her impaired function and post-exertional malaise. We taught her about rest and pacing. She definitely had widespread pain. So we started some really gentle physical therapy, put her on low-dose naltrexone and anti-inflammatory, which were very effective. For her orthostatic intolerance, she was treated with a beta blocker and fluids. We tried to add midodrine later. It was variably successful, but she eventually ended up on midodrine, which is, you know, like wearing compression in your chemical compression in your arms and legs. But the beta blocker was the most important. She was having, regardless of her POTS, heightened anxiety and panic attacks, and was getting a little OCD. Like she was measuring her blood pressure every 15 minutes all day and stuff like that, right? So we increased her escitalopram. We put her on some trazodone for sleep, lots of communication, and then we got her in with a chronic illness therapist who could help her manage and do better. And this was 7 months after this. She didn't meet criteria. These were basically her interventions for orthostatic intolerance here or for her pain. Here's her mental health and her baseline. And you can see that her hours of upright activity, her function was really quite good at that point. And her main symptoms were her anxiety and what I consider sort of fibromyalgia-like symptoms from her episode. And otherwise, she was doing pretty well. So this is, I just bring that up as an example of someone who really had both. And that by really immediately working on her POTS and her orthostatic and autonomic dysfunction, we were able to get it to come under immediate control and get her back to a baseline with her regular anxiety disorder. Dr. Yellman, any comments or thoughts?
Not on your case. There was a question in the chat. Is it truly mast cell activation or an upregulation of the genes that control the many processes that can increase histamine production? And might this impact therapies? And I just kind of pointed out, if I'm understanding the question correctly, that you know, mast cell activation is referring to excessive or inappropriate release of many inflammatory cytokines from mast cells. That includes histamine, but a lot of other mediators. And some of the symptoms that we are talking about today that are driving orthostatic intolerance, that drive sympathetic overdrive or anxiety response, are not just driven by histamine, but all these other mediators as well. And so in this population, those with sympathetic overdrive, I tend to reach for the mast cell stabilizers first. However, in our PASC population in general, all comers, it's certainly helpful to use histamine blockers or even things that reduce histamine in your food or your medications like a diamine oxidase. But that tends to be, I think, more helpful for the more traditional allergy ATP symptoms, you know, itching, urticaria, rhinorrhea, asthma-like symptoms, et cetera, as opposed to some of the sympathetic overdrive symptoms.
For one thing that like, A, the identical twin factor, I think is always really interesting because you sort of have the sort of natural experiment, the factor, you know, and I think in some ways it's hard for patients that they've seen a family member relative go through something, you know, it does have that heightened, you know, concern of what's going to happen to me. But also the it also, I think, really illustrates nicely that patients don't fall into nice, neat boxes. And I thought that the blood pressure results were actually particularly interesting in the difference between the nasaline test and the tilt table, because tilt table testing is so hard to get into traditionally, and just the access to it is hard. So I thought there were a number of really interesting aspects of that case. Thanks for presenting.
The other thing I'd like to add is I strongly feel, in hindsight, that had her sibling, her twin, been diagnosed with POTS early, that she may be a different person today. I think missing the diagnosis of dysautonomia for years creates severe ongoing longstanding problems. I don't know, because we can't turn back time, but this case kind of supports that for me, right? Because they're identical twins.
The other thing that the U Clinic is doing, we collected, one of my doctor and nursing practitioner students actually collected 200 patients that we saw on their PHQ-2, their PHQ-9, and their GAD-7. And then actually we're pulling apart some of their data to see sort of how long, you know, if they ever had previous diagnoses of psychiatric issues, or, and then what were their clinical diagnoses? How long has it been since they were had COVID, or how many times have they had COVID now? And then also like types of symptoms, referrals, and kind of looking back at that. So hopefully we'll have some interesting follow-up data that way. The other thing we did was, because people sometimes struggle to get into therapists right now, like we didn't have enough therapists before COVID, I feel like, and now people are really struggling to get access to mental health support. And so we put together a list that I can share of like free or low cost resources, at least in Utah. But that was something our patients found particularly helpful, because, you know, about a third of our patients are low income, considered low income.
Great to pass around. Thank you guys so much for your time, and Dr. Yellman for your lecture. Just as a reminder to everyone, you can submit a case, and our wonderful expert panel here can provide case recommendations. Our next session is on September 6th, where we'll be hearing from Dr. Bateman as she addresses chronic pain. Thank you all for your time. We'll see you on the 6th.